doesn't get picked for Ireland.
Gamble responsibly. Gamblingcare.ie.
Welcome back to Off the Ball Saturday here on News Talk. John Duggan with you through until 8 o'clock because we got commentary later on of Leinster against Exeter, so an extended show today. We're joined to speak about football by the former Republic of Ireland international Damien Delaney and the broadcaster and journalist Johnny Ward. You can text us 53106. Our coverage thanks to Paddy Power. For information on responsible gambling, visit gamblingcare.ie. We're streaming the conversation as well. So as well as listening on News Talk, you can watch us on the social channels for Periscope on Twitter at Off the Ball, YouTube, Facebook, and on the OTB Sports app. If you haven't downloaded that already for iOS and Android, you can do so. Good afternoon, lads. Hope you're well. Just before we get to the football, have you had a bet on the Grand National, Damien Delaney? Have you any interest in that kind of thing?
I didn't even know it was on. the Irish Grand National, yeah.
No, the English Grand National. It's 5:15. No worries.
I know nothing about that, to be honest. Sorry.
I didn't mean to curve your ball you so early, Damien.
That's grand.
Who do you like, JD?
Borough Saint.
Very, very solid.
And for you, Johnny?
I'm with Andy Second now. I think his prep is kind of similar to Papillon's and also Seabass that Ted Walsh trained. I actually opposed this horse on the basis of stamina in the Kim Muir 2 years ago. So maybe it's a bit daft thinking he'll win the National, but he was brilliant in his prep run. Like, he was absolutely brilliant beating Castle Grace Paddy so easily. Castle Grace Paddy ran really well at Ferry House. I think if he gets the trip, that's the big quandary. I think he's a great chance, but it's a fascinating race, really. A fascinating race. I might have half my eye on entry, but you know yourself, it's a big day in racing.
Absolutely, a big day. Big day for Leeds United as well. We'll keep you up to date as well, folks. Liverpool Villa, a really important game, kicking off at 3. Firmino and Milner into the Liverpool 11 today. Marvellous Nakamba and Trezeguet coming into the Villa side. Damien, you're watching Leeds and City. I know City got one eye on Dortmund, but to be fair to Leeds, they had a man down for half the game after Liam Cooper was sent off for a tackle on Jesus. And Stuart Dallas won it in injury time.
Incredible game of football. Really, really enjoyable. Leeds have added so much to the Premier League. I mean, they've come up with no fear. And even when they went down to 10 men, they worked so hard for their manager. They had this interesting man-for-man thing going on in the first half. And then Cooper gets sent off. But I mean, they sat back to an extent, but you know, with Rafinha and a couple of other players, they were a threat on the break. But their work rate, their dedication, their application of what the manager is asking them is a joy, if I'm being honest. It's beautiful to watch. And you could just sense as it got to the last 5 minutes, 85th minute, they had a couple of breakaways. Rafinha went through with one-on-one with Ederson. And Ederson made a sliding tackle, believe it or not. You'd have to see it to believe it. I mean, he came out and normally goalkeepers go with their hands, but he decided to slide tackle him, and like he was a centre-back, won the ball cleanly. And then there was a couple of other hints where, you know, Fernandinho, getting me Brazilians mixed up, got caught in a couple of 1v1 situations. So it was kind of, I wouldn't say it was coming, but there was the threat of Leeds. You know, when they're 1-1 with 2 minutes, to 3, 4, 5 minutes to go, it wasn't a case of just ride your luck and sit in. You know, they camped in their box when they had to, but they had a counterpunch, and it was brilliant to see, especially with 10 men.
Did he deserve to go, Liam Cooper? It was upgraded from the VAR.
I don't think so, but I know probably everyone's sick of the saying that in today's game it probably is a red card. He did go in, the ball was bouncing, and he went to clear it, and it was just kind of a follow through. But something that happens so fast, it's very hard to clear the ball and then pull your leg away, especially when Bernardo Silva was only only a couple of steps away from him. So I would have given the benefit of the doubt. It wasn't malicious. It was probably dangerous, but a red card, I think, is very, very harsh for what I would describe as a football incident.
Yeah. Leeds and Bielsa, there is a danger he might not stay. You'd hope that he would. And given the way they play in such an exciting manner, as you described there, Damien, you really hope they hold on to him.
I really hope so, too. I mean, I don't know the man. He does seem like a little bit an odd character, that's unfair, but, you know, kind of a maverick type character, I suppose, would be a fair assessment. So he could just pack up his tent and move on in the summer if he feels he's achieved all he can achieve with Leeds. You know, they've come up, his stock has probably got an all-time high. there might be the potential of a big job back in his homeland, or maybe even a big job on the continent somewhere. And I know Leeds fans would argue that Leeds is a huge club, but I think that he's a type of manager that might think if he's gone as far as he can go and he's kind of squeezed everything he can out of the football club, and you know, next year, second season syndrome is a possibility. There might be a period of kind of stability for Leeds where they have 3, 4, 5 years of just mid-table mediocrity, which is a great thing for Leeds if they could get that, and then hopefully build over time to getting back to where they should be, which is the upper echelons of the Premier League. But you know, to make the leap that they've made is great. They've had an exciting year, but to carry on at the pace they're going at, I think is impossible. Even with investment, there has to be a period of stability in the club. And I don't think he's the type of guy that would just kind of hang around for those kind of mid-table, win one, lose one, draw one type of season. So I hope they do. But if not, the club is in a great place. You know, we'll have some money to spend in the summer. They have the nucleus of a really good squad, a squad that got them promoted. So I believe that they are in a really good place, Leeds. And he does move on. Well, I tell you, he moves on having catapulted the club a huge distance.
53106 Leeds fans, if you want to get involved. 16 years they spent out of the top flight, Damien. If there's room for growth and improvement in the side, where is it?
If Bielsa stays, it'll just be more about upgrading the players that they have. They'll go for a similar profile of player, high energy, very, very athletic players, very, very tactically adaptable, as you saw today at Man City, players that have to be able to take information on board. You know, holding on to a couple of players might be an issue for them. Some players have had such a good season this year that potentially they could lose some players. But again, that would mean big money coming in, because Leeds, I don't think, would be in a position where they would have to sell. So they could recoup some huge money on players if they did decide, and maybe build an all-round squad. So I just think an upgrade, more physically capable players, fitter players, more athletic players, more tactic, better, basically a slight upgrade, but similar profile.
Sure. Is Calvin Phillips the man? Who's the main man for you at Leeds?
Rapinha, is it? Or Rafinha?
Yeah, Rafinha. Yeah.
Rafinha. He was great today. He's a little bit like a kind of an outsider in that Leeds team. He's just that X factor. Everyone else just works so hard and so diligently. He works hard too, give him his dues. But he really can provide that X factor for Leeds. And we saw it today a couple of times on the break. Manchester City were committing so many bodies forward. John Stones was almost playing like a number 10 at one point. Nathan Ake, when he was on the pitch, you know, he went off. But when he was on the pitch, both centre-backs were 20, 30 yards inside Leeds' half. And you just always felt that there was the possibility for turnover. And Leeds only got one or two. But when it broke to my man, Rafinha, on the edge of the box, he just picked the ball up and travelled. So I think he's a man that could move on. I'm not sure Calvin Phillips, people would be willing to pay huge money for him. Yeah. I mean, if somebody did come in and pay the money for him, I'm sure Leeds would consider moving him on. But, you know, for defensive midfield player, I think Leeds would need an eye-watering amount of money to be able to part with him. But I think people might be willing to spend it on Rafinha. I mean, he just is that X factor. I could see him fitting in somewhere out of Liverpool. Real kind of, not off the cuff, it's a touch unfair, but a real kind of street footballer, just picks the balls up and runs, and a handful to deal with. So I think all the top clubs would be interested in him, and he's one that they might be willing to part with.
It's eye-watering money. Sorry, Damien, his goal is between Liverpool and Villa at the moment, 10 minutes in at Anfield. City, can they get the job done against Dortmund in the second leg, Damien? They didn't start De Bruyne, Foden, Gundogan or Diaz today.
Yeah, I think so. In a funny way, I don't think Pep Guardiola will be too upset at today. I think the best thing to come out today is he did keep his big hitters' legs fresh for the weekend, or for the midweek game, sorry. In years gone by, when it was Liverpool and Manchester City that were neck and neck for the league, he wouldn't have been able to make changes and potentially risk the result that they got today, you know, because Liverpool and themselves were neck and neck, and you know, they knew the title was going to be decided by a couple of points. So he would have had to start the strongest 11 today, and then he might have gotten beat because players would have had a huge night during the week against Dortmund, a huge day today against Leeds. With the fight Leeds put up, they would have had their main men would have had to have been in top gear, and that might have made them a touch lethargic and then potentially open to the type of performance they put in the last number of years against the French teams in the Champions League when they got knocked out. So the beauty is the run they went on after Christmas, they've given themselves that cushion that they can afford a result like this. Just get through the next round, and then, you know, he has another, I think it's end of April, is the semi-finals of the Champions League if they get through. So he can kind of turn his focus back to the Premier League, pick up the couple of wins needed just to maintain that distance that he's, you know, that cushion, that distance that he's created. So I don't think he'd be too disappointed. I mean, obviously he would have wanted to have won the game, but absolutely one, if not both eyes were firmly on Dortmund during the week. So, you know, they've earned that right to make the changes and suffer the result they had today. I think they'll be right to go on Wednesday.
You enjoy the Leeds win, Johnny?
Oh, what a fantastic game, JD. You know, for a team to you know, to concede as few chances as they did against the 11 men of City after a red card that I think we should talk about, because I think it kind of brings VAR to the fore again, but it also brings up this issue of slow motion deciding what happened in the tackle or what happened in an incident. I think we should definitely talk about that. But just the quality of the pass as well into Dallas. And, you know, it was an amazing performance by Leeds to come back. And it was just a compelling game of football from start to finish. I thought Leeds were brilliant when it was 11-11. Obviously, I expected at halftime, you know, despite the changes that City made, it's so hard to play them with 11 men, not to mind 10. And Leeds parked the bus, but they actually did have chances in the game. And just the quality of that goal, it was really, really brilliant to watch. And, you know, I agree with Damien there. Obviously, they can kind of take their foot off the gas in the league. I think they do have some defensive issues that maybe have a little bit exposed as well. I didn't see all the game obviously during the week, but they did cough up chances and they rode their luck a little bit. I think maybe the quadruple is going to possibly be a step beyond them, but it was a fantastic game today, and Leeds doing their chance of finishing the top half no harm. It'd be interesting to see if they can kick on next season, because they have so much potential there.
He's just late, wasn't he, Liam Cooper, with that challenge, Damien?
I don't think he was late.
No.
I mean, the ball bounced. I think it was Jesus was in front of him, and he's gone and booted it 50 yards on the pitch. Now, because Jesus was so close to him, he won't be able to generate the amount of power to get the ball away and then pull his leg away in time. You know, it's impossible. Now, if Jesus was 3 or 4 feet away from him and he left his leg there and deliberately kept it straight, and you could see that he was, you know, following through and leaving one on Jesus, and I could say fair enough, but it was a clearance. I don't think there was any malice in it. I think yellow card would have sufficed. So I think the line that needs to be drawn is, I know it's difficult to kind of gauge a player's intentions, but sometimes the defenders have to get the benefit of the doubt that it's a footballing incident. There's a bouncing ball. As a defender, you have to clear it. If Liam Cooper takes his time going into that and is hesitant and thinks, well, if I catch him here, it's going to be a red card, and all of a sudden Jesus nicks the ball off him and runs through on goal and scores, well, he's not going to be playing football for Leeds United very much longer, because Bielsa is going to be absolutely livid with him for not defending properly. So he had to go for it in the manner that he went. It was just unfortunate that Jesus was so close to him, and he did catch him. But I think it was a genuine play on the ball, and there was no real intention. And if you do go and look at it in VAR and slow it down, it's very easy to say, oh yeah, he should have pulled his leg away. But I mean, there was inches from when he made connection with the ball to when he caught Jesus. Again, it is dangerous, but defenders have to be allowed to defend. I know it is difficult to ask referees to gauge players' intentions, but I just think that, you know, he has to go for that ball full-blooded, and he did.
You're saying it's dangerous, Damo. Like, getting on the pitch is dangerous. I mean, if we're not going to have any tackles, it's a complete attempt to get the ball. And we talk about trial by media, trial by social media. This is trial by slow-mo. And there are probably a lot of people watching that at home who changed their mind when they saw the slow-mo, because it's initially a full-blooded tackle. As the follow-through, obviously, there's a connection, and that's fine. That's the nature of the game. This is happening in a split second. But then when you see it in slow motion, nothing happens in slow motion. It didn't happen in slow motion. And you can then kind of say, oh, well, there was an intent there, or he followed through. He tried to kick the ball. It was a full-blooded challenge. He followed through, get on with the game. And, you know, even the referee who was on the TV coverage was like, I'd probably go for a yellow there. So there is a bit of conjecture in terms of whether you agree with the referee's decision, or maybe another referee would disagree. But it's this VAR by social media that I have a problem with, because it's not, or sorry, VAR by slow motion that I have a problem with, because Cooper is done by the fact that they slowed that down so much that you can see the follow through in a different light to what actually happened. And Leeds obviously shouldn't have gotten anything out of the game after that, and it would have been very harsh on them. But, you know, it was a big week for VAR and Man City games. But this, I think, showed that slow motion is a big, big issue, because nothing happened in slow motion, and it gave a picture of what happened there that wasn't real.
Damien?
Yeah, I agree. You know, it's very, very difficult I just stand by my earlier point that defenders have to be low defend, and there has to be the benefit of the doubt given. Now, if there was a clear, when he takes the ball and clears it, and he deliberately leaves his leg there for even a split second too long, you think he could have pulled it away, but I don't think he could have. He made connection with the ball and then caught Jesus. So, yellow was a feast, to be honest with you.
You obviously didn't play in the Premier League when they had the VAR came in after you left it. Do you speak to former teammates or ex-players, or just in terms of the players that are playing now, Damien, are they sick of it? What's the insider view, on all this?
I don't think so.
No?
The lads I speak to have gotten used to it. I think at the start there was obviously a huge upheaval in terms of waiting for results, waiting to celebrate goals, but it's become the normality now. And a couple of people I spoke to are, this is not a broad representation of everybody, it's only the couple of people I spoke to, are pleased with it. Because while it does get certain things wrong by today, but even like what we saw today, a lot of goals are being judged correctly in or out. Sometimes penalties are given and it was a dive and it's overturned, or vice versa. So I think on the whole, more results are true. They're fairer. Now, sometimes they're going to get certain things wrong. I'm not saying that they don't get everything wrong, because, even with the advent of slowing it down and looking at it, some stuff is still a judgment call for a referee. Contact, how much contact is enough for penalty? Obviously they had a black and white rule where handball was handball and any contact was deemed contact enough to be a penalty. So, there was a couple of teething issues, but I think initially people were just a little bit, thrown. People were saying, you don't get the emotion of when you score a goal, you're half afraid to celebrate. I think it's kind of settled in nicely into the Premier League, and I think there's a little bit of give and take with referees now, where they have a certain element of their own judgment, where they can go and look at an incident like today, and Andre Mariner obviously deemed that was a red card, and that's okay. It's a judgment call, it's borderline. Some people would say it was a red card, or people would say it won't, and it's the same when it comes to contact. So there's still an element of doubt, but I'm just saying on the whole, I think results are truer now.
The Athletic are reporting this morning that Harry Kane wants to leave Spurs in the summer. He's got 3 years left in his contract. It's going to cost a lot of money for Daniel Levy to sell him. If you're a club like City who need a striker, Damien, do you break the bank to sign Harry Kane, or do you look to maybe get Haaland in?
Well, I think you go for either of them, really. If it depends on the price, the value for money there. I think Haaland, obviously you're going to have an awful lot more longevity with him, and he could be the main man leading your front line for the next 7, 8, 9 years, possibly, when you look at his age. So if the price was reasonable, I think you'd obviously go for Haaland just because of the age profile. But if Harry Kane would not be a disappointment to any Manchester City fan, I wonder if Manchester City have the money. Of course they have the money, but will they be able to spend it with the financial fair play? They've been under the spotlight in the Premier League and in Europe as well in terms of money. So maybe they have to kind of keep their head down a little bit. That if they do go out and spend this money, people will start raising questions again. And maybe they might get dragged through some sort of a court case. But I'm pretty sure that if they have the money and if they can spend it, they will go for one of them, especially with Aguero moving on. Aguero has been such value for Manchester City. The last 8 or 9 years, he's been the main man. And I think that Haaland or Harry Kane would fit that. Now, getting Harry Kane out of Tottenham is going to be tricky. Daniel Levy is a notoriously difficult negotiator. Notoriously drives a very, very hard bargain, never lets anybody or anything leave on the cheap for his football club, and will leave it right till deadline day. He's done it for years. The only person he let go reasonably quick, I suppose, was Gareth Bale, because he got the money required. If City stump up the money required, then I'm pretty sure the Spurs would let him go, but I don't think it'll be easy to get him out of there.
Would it be a disaster for Spurs, Damien, if he left?
Absolutely, yeah, I think so. Even with that money, it would require every penny of the money they receive plus another 30, 40 million to try and redress the squad. Now, maybe Jose Mourinho would be happy with that. Maybe they could buy a couple of centre-backs, maybe a full-back, some midfield players. But I think replacing the goals that Harry Kane gives you is a very, very difficult task. So, if I was Spurs, I'd prefer to keep Harry Kane and spend 50, 60 million and kind of improve the squad that way. But Convincing Harry Kane to stay now is difficult. In fairness to him, he's given Spurs everything. He's stayed loyal for so long. But I suppose there comes a time where he does want to go and improve his record record with trophy. Sorry, so it'll be interesting.
I'll bring you in on this, Johnny, in a moment. I'm just go on, Johnny.
Yeah. Do you think if Spurs dig their heels in, and obviously his age is a factor, and they don't sell him and he's locked into this long contract, do you think Kane's performance for Spurs will suffer because he's kind of locked into a club that at the moment isn't really going anywhere, and he's kind of probably going to realise that he's missed his chance, but he'll probably be annoyed with the club as well for not letting him go, despite the fact that they're not under any obligation to let him go. Will his performance then start suffering because mentally he mightn't be there anymore? And that's what I'm wondering as a Spurs fan, I guess.
I wouldn't have said so. You know, the type of character that he is, he's still captain of England. There's still a World Cup coming up in Qatar, obviously after the European Championships this year. So I think Harry Kane has enough motivation to stay focused and keep scoring goals just from a personal point of view and a selfish point of view. There will be no point in cutting off his nose despite his faith. But what Spurs might be looking at is, you know, in terms of the value for his age profile, that I'm pretty sure if Harry Kane was 25, Spurs probably wouldn't sell him for a king's ransom. But he's getting on a little bit now. There has to be an inevitable slowdown. His injury record is not terrible. Don't get me wrong. I'm not like, you know, having to go Harry Kane. But, you know, he has picked up a number of injuries. He's missed a number of games the last couple of seasons. He's a lot of mileage on the clock. If somebody's willing to play over the odds for what Spurs would value him, and they would have to pay over the odds, I think, then I think Spurs might be looking or willing to let him move on and rebuild a squad. And whether Jose gets that job or not is obviously the question.
I was watching Pochettino talking to Mbappe on the sideline the other day, kind of wondering where it all went wrong.
For
Spurs?
Oh, for Spurs? They didn't spend the money. Unfortunately, you know, they had the huge burden of the stadium. You know, Arsenal went through something similar when they kind of financed their stadium by selling some stars at the top end and kind of replacing them, not with like for like, but potential that might kind of progress and become superstars, but not enough of them did progress. I think Spurs have kind of suffering from the same fate, to be honest with you. You know, you take out a huge mortgage on a stadium like that, it's very, very difficult then to finance a squad rebuild, really. And that's what Pochettino needed the day after the Champions League final defeat to Liverpool. He needed to get 100 million and move on what needed moving on and kind of rejig a lot of things and go again. And they never really got that. He never really got that as a manager, and it became very, very difficult to him. That squad, it was a small squad insofar as the amount of players that he used. It was always a very, very predictable starting 11, bar one or two players. And I just think a lot of them had a lot of miles on the clock, very, very tired, had given so much. A couple of contractual issues when you think of what happened with Eriksen, when they wouldn't kind of give him the contract that he deserved, when for a period of time there, Eriksen was one of the best players in the Premier League, if not Europe. So, you know, it just kind of needed reinvigorating, and he never got it. And unfortunately, his motivation and management skills didn't stretch far enough to kind of keep that kind of ball moving. So I suppose that's where it went wrong, in my opinion.
Yeah, no, well said. 5-3-1-0-6. Hi, lads. Speaking of the Man City Leeds game earlier, Northern Ireland international Stuart Dallas, the goal scorer for Leeds, look a cracking player, could be one that could benefit from an all-Ireland football team. Your thoughts, Johnny?
Yeah, you should probably put that to the boys in Loyalist East Belfast just the last few days, see what they make of it. Yeah, I'd love to see it. I'd love to see it, but yeah, at the moment.
Let's keep it light, John. Let's keep it light, yeah.
Yeah.
I thought the Grand National was a curveball, Damien. That's another level.
I'd love to see it, JD. I'm not sure it'll precede an All-Ireland, United Ireland itself, but at the moment you'd probably say that Northern Ireland are better than us. Yeah, it's probably not the best time to bring that up.
Okay. There's a stoppage in the Liverpool-Villa game at the moment at Anfield where it's goalless. The other night, I was thinking to myself, Liverpool produced the miracle against Barcelona a couple of years ago, Damien, but I can't see it happen against Real Madrid. I think their Champions League campaign is over. Do you agree?
Oh, I don't know, you know. Not by virtue of the fact that, you know, I definitely think Liverpool are a different squad or in a different place right now. I don't think they have that same kind of electric, magnetic enthusiasm that they had that night against Barcelona that you always felt they were capable of. But I don't think Real Madrid are in a fantastic place either. And I think Liverpool's kind of catastrophic performance in Madrid can be equaled by Real Madrid at Anfield. You know, they're two teams that aren't in a good place. Now, granted, I'll give you Real Madrid had a good night and it all kind of clicked and all the good players had good games and they thoroughly deserved their victory. But a reversal of the scoreline wouldn't be totally out the window. If Liverpool were playing against a Bayern Munich or, you know, dare I say, a Man City who are in a good place at the moment and they're 3-1 down, then I would agree with you. I would say, look, these teams, you know, they're in really good places. Don't give up those types of first leg leads. But I just, Real Madrid are okay. They're fragile too. So I wouldn't write it off completely or the possibility. It's not beyond the realms of possibility. Might be highly unlikely, but so was the Barcelona result. But I don't think all hope is lost because Liverpool can, on their day, kind of click and kind of relive some past glories of the last number of years with a one-off performance that could get them through. And as I said, that allied to Real Madrid's fragility, it's a game I'm really looking forward to.
If you were alongside Trent Alexander-Arnold in a defence at the moment, Damien, what would you be saying to him? Is it a technical issue with him or is it a confidence thing? What's this about his form?
I think he's not the only one. He's obviously getting highlighted the most because he isn't having a great time. I suppose a lot of his defensive issues are coming because he hasn't got a rock-solid centre-back inside him, a Matip or a Virgil van Dijk, where he can just bomb forward and attack. But obviously when Nat Phillips gets left exposed when Trent leaves him exposed, those areas are getting kind of exploited. Whereas he can afford to leave Van Dijk or Matip or Gomez exposed because they'll tidy it up and it never really becomes a problem or it never becomes visible. He's had a small drop-off. And I like the fact that he's got a very, very young centre-back inside him who's not at the same level as the ones I just mentioned. So it's just a culmination of things, really. It's not an ideal situation for him. But having said that, he does look shot on confidence as well.
They could do probably Johnny with a couple of months on the beach, Liverpool, I would say.
Well, definitely, because you got to remember, as much as they had, you know, the coronavirus, enforced break, they were probably sort of training away. And then the intensity that they...
Johnny, we just have lost the connection to Johnny Ward there.
Julie. They were obviously catapulted into this season after not having a proper break. And they've just not been able to recover. Trent Alexander-Arnold, I think Robertson's had a poor season as well. I think they've massively...
No, we've got a few gremlins with Johnny Ward's line. Damien, do you want to pick up that issue about Liverpool maybe just needing a break, or do you see it that way?
Well, I'd say a break now wouldn't be much of a help to Liverpool. There's probably signs of what I just mentioned with Tottenham earlier, a team that's been on the road a long time, a manager that works his players extremely, extremely hard, and a lot of players have put up a lot of miles in the last 3 years. Liverpool have been relentless in everything that they've done. And I think that they're in need. Rebuild is too strong a word, I suppose, but they're in need of an injection or they're in danger of going the same way as Spurs if the club don't stump up the money. And I think that's what Jurgen Klopp knows, that to play for Jurgen Klopp is a shelf life because you really... His training sessions are legendary, as is Pochettino's, you know, the intensity of them. And to do that and to play football to required level requires an enormous amount of effort. And sometimes players just run out of steam. And I think Bobby Firmino's a case in point. You know, he was really a talismanic type figure for them previous to this year, where his work ethic, his drive, he didn't have the numbers. He almost certainly, you know, contributed so much to what Liverpool were doing. But he just looks like he's been flogged to death. And he just doesn't have the same amount of energy. Now, I know Liverpool have tried to ham and egg the rebuild that I speak of with the likes of Diego Jota, Thiago Alcantara. They've kind of gone, well, we don't want to spend all the money, so we're going to kind of get in players that we think can help us. Jota, Alcantara, obviously the centre-back, the Turkish lad.
Kabak, yeah.
They brought him in as well. So I think in the summer, I'm going to say there probably needs to be upwards of 100 million spent on Liverpool, you know, in an attacker, because those front three, I know they have Jota as support, but I don't think Jota is the same level as those guys. And we might develop in time in the next couple of years. He might actually develop into that. But the other three seemed knackered, to be honest here. So they probably want to have another one in. In fact, they might even want to move Firmino on to try and recoup some money. But I'd say they would really want to go and get a Haaland-type player. You know, a real statement to say that we are rebuilding. Alex Ferguson used to do it every year at Manchester United. When you think of all the centre-forwards, he just scoured the UK and got the best one. So I think Liverpool need a Haaland. And I think they need... is it Konate at Leipzig? The centre-back, is that his name?
Yeah.
Konate. So they want to go and get him. And probably another midfielder as well if Gini Wijnaldum goes on. So I'm going to say there needs to be upward of 100 million spent to keep Liverpool relevant.
But what you're saying is, like Alisson and Van Dijk, they need game changers, because the manager's not going to leave. Unlike Spurs, Pochettino left. He didn't get the chance to rebuild the squad. And you pointed out the reasons why, structurally with the club. But Liverpool need the big signings now. Because Mbappe was being very complimentary of Liverpool, but you'd wonder if he'd go there now.
I think they would. You know, your managers would sign for Jurgen Klopp, absolutely. You know, even if Liverpool were in the Europa League next year, I think players would recognise that Liverpool have had an off year where it's gone catastrophically wrong. And I think any player would look and think that Liverpool, with the right, if the player got the assurances that the right amount of investment and the right type of changes are going to be made, that they will be challenging for the Premier League next year. So you do say that, you know, Klopp isn't going to leave. I don't know. I don't think he is, but I think it's a possibility. I think if he doesn't get the funds that he clearly knows are required, Jurgen Klopp isn't certainly going to stay there and keep kind of beating that drum of knowing that it's not going to go anywhere, because the players are out on their feet. Especially if they keep giving them 20, 25 million pound signings that aren't really game changers. I think his stock is still reasonably high. And, you know, the possibility of the German job being available in the summer might appeal to him. Or maybe there's another job somewhere. It's unlikely, but I think it's a possibility.
We got a text in here, 53106. He will not welcome the gushing praise, but to my mind, the best football pundit on Irish TV and radio is Damien Delaney, considered, not cliched, an absent overstatement. Hats off, says Aaron.
Thank you, Aaron.
Johnny, that's fantastic stuff. Johnny, we have you back. Liverpool, it was interesting what Damien was saying there, and I thought an accurate assessment of where they are at the moment.
Yeah, I'm not sure they need a huge injection of new talent, and I'm also not sure if Mbappe or Haaland are even you know, possibilities, despite the fact that Mbappe obviously is complimentary. I think either would make a massive difference to them and would suit them hugely, because Liverpool they're not the most complex team in the world. You know, their job is to get the, you know, basically get the front three in action, rely on Van Dijk when he's fit, that you can play that high pressing game, which is now gone because he's not there anymore. But they've had so many catastrophes this season that you can almost kind of write it off to some extent, and they need to hit the reset button. If they get the players back fit, that and if their best 11, Van Dijk and the three up front, you mentioned Firmino and Damien, I mean, Mane's gone off a cliff as well. His form has nosedived, and the two fullbacks have, by their standards, have had poor seasons. Alisson has made mistakes that you wouldn't expect. You know, I think the loss of Henderson has been huge as well. They've had an awful lot go wrong. So I think if they could salvage the top four, get into the Champions League, and kind of maybe they'll lose, they will lose against Real, I think that wouldn't be the worst. But I think in terms of the fairy tale against Real, JD, I think their home form this season has been so poor. Over the course of their league games at home, they've scored 4 goals more than they've conceded in 15-odd games, which is unbelievable. It just shows that... I think after a while, these home games are more of a burden without any crowd there. I wonder, like, what advantage the Aviva Stadium was starting against Luxembourg in the second half, when all they could hear was the ghosts of the crowd, and, you know, they could just hear their own kind of anxieties, I guess, and, you know, as the away team grows in confidence, Anfield doesn't matter anymore. And that's why I think the Real game, there's very little chance Liverpool coming back, because they're so poor defensively and they're so kind of prone to losing their confidence in these games. If you had
a rip-roaring Anfield crowd. Boris Johnson said, yeah, we're opening up. You can have crowds back in the game. Again, it could be like the last game where Liverpool had a full crowd would have been Atletico, where they played very well. I think they could possibly do it. I don't think they have any chance. Anfield has become more of a problem than anything else for them. And it's really, really interesting to see how Klopp regenerates this. But I do think we should point out they badly need a break. And if they can get their best players back fit and fresh next season, I still think they have a massive, massive chance of winning the league and going on to good things next season. But just at the moment, I think they badly need a break mentally and physically.
Okay, we got to take a break. Before we go to it, let's get an update from Liverpool's game against Aston Villa in the Premier League. This is Shane Pennington.
It's Liverpool 0, Aston Villa 0, but Jurgen Klopp will definitely be disappointed his side aren't in front here. They continue to create chance after chance, but unfortunately haven't took any of them. Diego Jota's just headed over from a corner from this left-hand side from 6 yards out, and Trent Alexander-Arnold's also gone close with a 25-yard free kick that went just over the top of the crossbar. At the other end, Aston Villa have had their first opportunity of the game across from this right-hand side, finding the head of Ezri Konsa, whose 6-yard header forced a fairly comfortable save in the end from Alisson in the Liverpool goal. It's Liverpool 0, Aston Villa 0.
Earlier, Leeds beat Man City 2-1. OTB Football Saturday with Damien Delaney and Johnny Ward is back after this.
Football on Off the Ball
with Paddy Power. Let's be honest. If you were Declan Rice or Jack Grealish, you'd choose England too.
Gamble responsibly. Gamblingcare.ie.
The Hard Shoulder.
Almost 16,500 children are on a waiting list for an initial assessment for speech and language therapy.
The longer they're forced to wait, the worse the problem gets. Successive governments are to blame.
Charlie will not speak without intervention.
He has the odd words that I can understand.
At this stage, we really feel he's not going to be seen.
We've uncovered that the HSE is planning to remove the on-site speech and language therapist from the Holy Family School for the Deaf in Cabra.
The loss of that support for our children is critical.
They have to reverse the decision. They have to.
We can exclusively reveal that Anne Rabbitt, the junior minister for disability, has ordered the HSE to stop the removal of on-site specialists from special needs schools.
The Hard Shoulder with Kieran Cudahy.
With Nissan.
Weekdays from 4 on News Talk.
This is the tip of the iceberg. We're going to continue to give these children a voice.
Having a flutter? Top tip, quinbet.com. Ireland's newest online sportsbook and casino. For all your horse racing, football, casino and more, QuinnBet has you covered. With live in-play markets on mobile, PC and app. QuinnBet.com. Terms and conditions apply. Gamble responsibly. Visit gambleaware.ie.
Are you ready to make a difference to people's lives around the world? MSD Ireland is at the forefront of technology, problem solving and discovery. Our team at MSD Dunboyne Biologics are recruiting. Join us and work with our first-class teams who are committed to making a difference and impacting tomorrow today. Apply now at jobs.msd.com/Ireland. MSD Ireland. Inventing for life.
Get away and book a stay this year in the Talbot Collection of four-star hotels in Wexford, Cork, Carlow and Dublin from just €129 for couples and €199 for families. Plus, kids stay free. Enjoy outdoor activities and access to our leisure clubs. For flexible booking options, visit talbotcollection.ie.
We're living in Nace.
And we're going to drop into downward facing dog.
Yeah, I have. Hang on. I have three kids and sorry now, I'm just a little bit upside down here.
Want to talk life insurance while doing yoga in your living room? Now you can. Chat from home by video or phone with your financial broker or advisor about protecting your family with Irish Life. Get peace of mind knowing they're protected and really strengthen your core at the same time. We know Irish Life. We are Irish Life. Irish Life Assurance PLC is regulated by the Central Bank of Ireland.
Audi Ireland's dealer network is here to help you choose your new Audi. Browse our range of petrol, diesel, hybrid and fully electric vehicles online. The health and safety of staff and customers remains our priority. We have social distancing measures and personalised solutions in place to help you experience and safely choose the right Audi for you. Contact your local authorised Audi dealer today to arrange an appointment. Future is an attitude. Future is an Audi.
Aldi's amazing Grocery 6 back-to-school offers. Six of your favourite products at unbeatable prices every week. This week, save up to 50% on lunchbox favourites like lighter sliced mild red cheese, family pan white bread and rice cake bars, now just 69 cent each. Kids water 10 pack, deli styled crumbed ham and paper lunch bags 50 pack, now only 1.49 each. Bags of back to school offers there. In store now, see aldi.ie for terms. Aldi, every day amazing.
While adhering to restrictions at our beaches, rivers and lakes, put safety first. Safe supervises children closely. Safe stays away from the water's edge. Safe wears a life jacket on or near water. This is Water Safety Ireland. Better safe than sorry. For advice, visit watersafety.ie, an initiative of the Government of Ireland.
If you're experiencing hearing loss or know someone who is, this ad is definitely worth listening to. Treatment benefit for hearing aids has improved. Now you can get up to €500 towards the cost of each hearing aid and up to €100 for repairs. Sounds great, doesn't it? To find out more, visit gov.ie/treatment benefit. A Government of Ireland initiative brought to you by the Department of Social Protection.
Any news?
No. You?
No. Nothing exciting.
Too much in the weekend, or...?
Nah. Yourself?
Oh, we... What did we do?
Need something new to talk about? Like Energia's great deals. Come direct to Energia for the best savings on your home energy. It's news we're more than happy to share with you. Switch at energia.ie. Rated excellent on Trustpilot. Energia. The power behind your savings.
The Lotto jackpot is an estimated €12 million. Play responsibly in store, in app, or at lottery.ie. The National Lottery. It could be you.
Leaders Lounge, the premium online leadership event, returns on April 22nd with a world-class panel of successful leaders. Razi Erasmus, in conversation with Paul McGinley, reveals the principles he used to transform South African rugby to World Cup victory. Brian O'Driscoll and Joanna Reardon on their diverse and inspiring leadership journeys. And Chanel McCoy analyzes the evolution of the modern business leader. This compelling event is a must-see. Leaders Lounge, Thursday, April 22nd. Book now at leadersloungelive.com.
Football on Off the Ball
with Paddy Power. Jack Byrne is the new Wes. Skillful, picks a pass, and doesn't get picked for Ireland.
Gamble responsibly. Gamblingcare.ie.
Welcome back to Off the Ball Saturday here on News Talk. John Duggan with you through until 8 because we've got commentary later of Leinster and Exeter in the Champions Cup. Joined by Damien Delaney, the former Republic of Ireland defender, and Johnny Ward to talk about the beautiful game. Thanks to Paddy Power for information on responsible gambling. Visit gamblingcare.ie. Aston Villa 1, Liverpool 0. Oddie Watkins has just scored for Villa. Bad mistake from Alisson. Should have saved it. Slipped through his body and into the back of the net, and Villa are 1-0 up coming up to half time in the Premier League. Other European matches during the week. It's funny, Damien, like Chelsea just quietly going about their business. I know they lost to West Brom, but they had only 10 players for a lot of the game, and now into probably a Champions League semi-final, you'd have to think.
Yeah, you'd think so. Their ability to defend, the way Thomas Tuchel has transformed Chelsea defensively has been brilliant, really. And that's the foundation or the bedrock that he's built Chelsea's resurgence on. So with the lead they have, it should be enough. But I think Porto have a couple of players who were missing the other night back. I think is it Mehdi Taremi and Oliveira, I think. One of them is back, Mehdi Taremi, I think. So it's not done and dusted by any stretch, but I think Chelsea have enough capability, enough know-how, and are defensively strong enough. I think it's the other end of the pitch where Chelsea are struggling. No, I know it sounds crazy because they won 2-0, but they're just not as free-flowing or as fluid as what their attacking talent would suggest. Mason Mount seems to be carrying the whole of Chelsea attack on his back at the moment, and he's doing a splendid job. But Kai Havertz, Werner, Ziyech, Pulisic, none of them really are I'm going to say even contributing. Werner worked really, really hard, and his work ethic is really, really good. But in terms of contribution, goals, assists, is zero. But I suppose giving the defenders just credit for clean sheets isn't fair either. You know, defending is a team game. Everyone's contributing to the defensive solidity that they have. But I think they should get through. They're on the good side of the draw as well. Potentially a game against Real Madrid. I think that's the side of the draw. Am I right in saying that? It would be interesting to see maybe Chelsea, Real Madrid against Man City, potentially in the Man City PSG or Bayern, obviously, in the final. It'll be interesting. It's all good at the minute, though.
Bayern PSG was one of, I think, probably the game I enjoyed most since we went into this crazy lockdown.
Yeah, it was a cracking game, wasn't it? Two teams just took the handbrake off and just went at each other. Bayern Munich have showed a few defensive frailties that maybe they didn't show last year. They were so good last year defensively and in an attacking sense. But there's a little bit of a question mark over them. Oh my God. Yes.
Firmino.
Yeah. That was a bit of a screwball scramble.
Now that Liverpool have managed an equaliser at home against Villa, is that an oh my God moment at the moment?
Defending.
Sorry, it was just the manner of what. Oh, I might be offside. Oh no, I think he's okay. I think it jotted us really, really well to get in. Sorry, I'm switching subject here, but he pulls it back and it just seems to take forever. They're playing 1-2. It's a little lucky deflection, and Firmino with a really, really good finish.
Ask you, Damo, the Mbappe goal, the winner. As a defender, like, what can you say when someone does that? That little kind of momentary kind of faint, and just like, what can you do?
Well, you have to, even though you know there's a possibility that is going to be a feint or a little shimmy, as a defender, you can't take the risk of gambling on that, if you know what I mean. Is this going to be ruled out for handball?
They're checking the goal for possible offside at the moment.
You love that, so you're probably delighted.
I know. Listen, as long as they come to the right decision, then I think it'll be fine. We'll come back to that anyway. Sorry.
Yeah, well, it's 1-1 at the moment, but we're just waiting to see what VAR decrees Roberto Firmino. But you go on there, you're talking about Mbappe.
When he has that shimmy of a shot, Boateng has to think that that's actually going to happen and has to react to that. Unfortunately, for PSG, he did bite on that little shimmy and then he just whips it near post, and the keeper had no chance. But it was a fantastic goal. They're really playing well at the minute, PSG. I know just domestically they're not, but in Europe he really does seem to have them in a good place, Pochettino. And it was a really, really good decision from PSG to change manager, because I suppose they're sick of Ligue 1 titles. And the main thing now is, I'm just trying to watch this, John, over the corner.
The geometry kits. I can't. I know this is the radio and everything, but just focus, because we obviously have the screen of the Liverpool Villa game. I've got my head in my hands here, because for anybody who's watching.
I think you should be onside.
The geometry kit is out, and it's back to when you're. It's back to when you were 10, and you got that thing. Remember that Oxford little compass thing you got at Christmas time or whatever? I don't know.
This is the nonsense of it. I don't even know what you're talking about here, but like, this is absolutely nonsense.
VAR geometry kits.
We would have had a controversial decision one way or the other. Firmino would have scored or would have not have scored. There may have been another attack. Instead, we're talking about it and you're distracted for the last 3 minutes.
But I tell you what, John, right? It's been ruled out for offside. And the only thing of all the praise I gave VAR is that the line they drew was off the elbow. And sometimes it's where they draw the line. Is it the armpit or is it the elbow? I know you're splitting hairs now, John. It's fine.
How do they even know? You're on about like slow-mo. How do they even know if you slow-mo? When does the ball actually leave his foot? Because the ball will be touching the foot for so long that how can you even know exactly when the ball left his foot? It's such a nonsense.
We're in the 51st minute of the first half.
The geometry crits have ruled out Roberto Firmino's goal. But this is no fun though, Damien. I know it's right, but it's not any fun. This is not football, is it?
So what's more fun? Villa fans absolutely livid afterwards that Firmino was offside. Then people get to go back to the things of like, oh well, you know, decisions even themselves out over the course of the year. They're consistent with this. So sometimes it's gone Liverpool's way, sometimes it's gone Villa's way. Everybody's kind of on the receiving end or of a good decision or a bad decision. Ultimately, I think they've got it right. I think. Just if they've drawn the lines in the correct place, they have. So ultimately, it's people can argue about VAR, but I think it's the right decision.
Yeah, I can't.
it's taken the joy out of it, JD, you know, and it's
I prefer life to be grey. I prefer, like, was football broken before VAR?
No, but there was.
Not a big deal. Like, what role does a referee even have in a game now? Why would you want to be a referee when at the top level when it's just like, well, sure, it's VAR decides everything. Are we just going the way of computers, artificial intelligence, and all this for everything? Like, can we not have humans making mistakes, and can we not have controversial decisions? I put up a poll on Twitter, I think last year, if you're a League of Ireland fan, do you want VAR? And it was something like 85% no. And I could see why. I hate VAR. I hate how it's just taking the enjoyment out of the game, how it's taken a split second goal and turn it into a 5-minute dilemma, and after which you still don't really know the right answer. Just get rid of it.
No, I disagree with you, John. You're harping back that football was a happy utopia before VAR. It just means we're arguing about VAR now instead of actual decisions. So look, it's offside to the letter of the law. They're playing consistently, so you just have to live with it and move on.
We've got about 90 seconds. We can just briefly mention Arsenal. We might get to them after four. Damien, you watched the game against Slavia Prague. Is it just a case that they're not progressing the way they should be at the moment? It's just very frustrating for their supporters.
Yeah, I think Arsenal have kind of slipped to being a mid-table Premier League team. I think that's just the unfortunate kind of way of the world. The reality, really, is that they're just no longer... You know, they're a big football club support-wise, but, I mean, they are so far away from competing at the Champions League level, never mind the latter stages of the Champions League at this time of the year. I'd say they're probably about £700 million away from that at the minute. Okay. I'm not sure that's an exaggeration.
Sure, we'll touch upon that after the break, after 4 o'clock. And Liverpool trailing Aston Villa, we can clarify, by a goal to nil at halftime. We're back after the news with OTB Football Saturday. Damien Delaney and Johnny Ward, 53106 for your texts.
Football on Off the Ball
with Paddy Power. Champions League nights on Off the Ball. Bigger than Zlatan's ego.
Gamble responsibly. Gamblingcare.ie.
Sign up for News Talk Extra, our email newsletter straight to your inbox. Newstalk.com/extra.
The famous Holland and Barrett 1 cent sale is back, with buy one get one for just 1 cent on hundreds of everyday favourites, and you can even mix and match. Welcoming you to shop safely in-store or at hollandandbarrett.ie. And 11th of the 5th, 2021, selected items, cheapest item 1 cent, subject to availability.
Afternoons are easy with InsureMyVan.ie, Ireland's low-cost van insurance specialists. Get your business back on the road with InsureMyVan's best price guarantee. For super savings, visit InsureMyVan.ie. City Financial Marketing Group Limited, training as InsureMyVan.ie, is regulated by the Central Bank of Ireland.
Whoa, whoa, whoa. Shoes off when you're inside, please.
At Audi, book a major service or timing belt kit on audiservice.ie and you'll receive a complimentary set of Audi Genuine floor mats worth €125. You'll be forgiven for being a little overprotective. Book now on audiservice.ie. Terms and conditions apply.
Sean, what's that thing going round the garden?
That is our new Husqvarna auto mower.
Auto mower?
Yeah, it's a robotic lawnmower from Husqvarna. Cuts the grass automatically, has GPS tracking and an app. Even works in the rain. I just thought, why spend time cutting grass when I could spend it with the family?
Great! You can put the dinner on, so...
Ah, no can do, love. I have to paint the man cave.
Husqvarna auto mower. Never mow again. Learn more at husqvarna.ie.
Welcome to Go Loud Jazz, the new home for jazz music in all its forms. Big band, bebop, smooth, and everything in between. Featuring a mix of new tunes and famous tracks by legendary artists, from Monk and Davis, Parker and Coltrane, to Ella and Billy. Go Loud Jazz. Fascinating rhythms. Download the Go Loud app now for free. Go Loud. Podcasts, radio, and music to your ears.
Planning to give your office a facelift? Need help optimizing your workspace to meet the new health and safety guidelines? The team at Hunt Office Interiors can help with all of your planning, design and project management requirements. We provide a full range of solutions from office furniture and seating to state-of-the-art glass partitions. With ultra-modern showrooms in City West and Limerick, we'd love to show you what we're made of. To connect with our interiors team, simply email interiors@huntoffice.ie. Serving Ireland's business community for over 21 years, Hunt Office.
As the country reopens, testing is vital to stop the spread of the virus and help businesses reopen safely. At MyBio, the award-winning Irish pharma company, our rapid antigen test takes just 15 minutes, and COVID results are available on the spot. MyBio's rapid antigen test is inexpensive, highly accurate, and best of all, easy to use. So if you're looking for peace of mind for employees or family members, order your MyBio rapid antigen tests now, with next-day delivery at mybio.ie.
Have you heard about Loving 30? It's a campaign to save lives and make our roads safer.
Dublin City Council is proposing extending the 30-kilometre speed limit across most of the city. We want to make the roads safer for everyone. For pedestrians, for cyclists and for all motorists. Driving at 30 kilometres per hour improves driver reaction and braking distance, and it saves lives.
Have your say and help make Dublin a safer city. Log on to www.dublincity.ie/loving30 before April 23rd. Loving 30. Slow down. Save lives. A message from Dublin City Council.
Over 800,000 people tune into News Talk every week. They tune in to listen. They're engaged, interested, maybe even interested in your business. Whether you're selling to customers, to businesses, selling online, or getting ready to reopen, your next customer could be listening right now. If you'd like to talk to them, talk to us. Email advertising@newstalk.com.
This spring, Disney Plus brings you more with Star.
Here we go.
More brand new originals like the Oscar-nominated Nomadland.
I'm not homeless. I'm just houseless.
New shows like Dollface starring Kat Dennings.
I'll see you there.
And Grown-ish starring Yara Shahidi.
You are so right.
Plus series you love like 16 seasons of Grey's Anatomy.
You need to calm down.
And over 300 episodes of Family Guy. There's more to discover with Star.
I'm ready.
Only on Disney Plus. 18 plus subscription required. T's and C's apply.
Leaders Lounge, the premium online leadership event, returns on April 22nd with a world-class panel of successful leaders. Razi Erasmus, in conversation with Paul McGinley, reveals the principles he used to transform South African rugby to World Cup victory. Brian O'Driscoll and Joanna Reardon on their diverse and inspiring leadership journeys. And Chanel McCoy analyzes the evolution of the modern business leader. This compelling event is a must-see. Leaders Lounge, Thursday, April 22nd. Book now at leadersloungelive.com.
The Lotto jackpot is an estimated 12 million euro. Play responsibly in store, in app, or at lottery.ie. The National Lottery. It could be you.
Across Ireland. This is the IMRO Radio Awards National Station of the Year. This is News Talk.
It's 4 o'clock. Good afternoon. I'm Stephen Burke. The High Court will hold a constitutional inquiry into the detention of a woman who's been in a quarantine hotel in Dublin since arriving from Israel on Wednesday. Inbar Avizier has been vaccinated against COVID-19 and has given details of two negative tests. Adrian Harmon reports.
At a sitting earlier today, Justice Shannon Allen granted the request for an inquiry. It came after senior counsel Michael Cush, representing the Minister for Health, acknowledged for the purposes of this case that Ms. Avizier was being detained. Her senior counsel, Conor Power, said given it was a quarantine case, there would be no application for bail. It was agreed that submissions on the case would be made tomorrow, with the matter due before the President of the High Court on Monday.
Meanwhile, another 16 states will be put on the high-risk list for quarantine from next Thursday, including Canada, France, Italy, Belgium and the United States. Minister of State for European Affairs Thomas Byrne says Ireland isn't alone in Europe in tightening the rules.
Member states are free to take temporary travel measures, and many have, and indeed some countries have banned travel from Ireland at various points. But the key thing is that these are reasonable and proportionate and temporary.
Two men charged in connection with riots in West Belfast earlier this week have been denied bail. 32-year-old Matthew Shaw with an address in Portadown and 25-year-old Jonathan Maitland from Lanark Way in Belfast both appeared before Belfast Magistrates Court earlier. The two were detained on Thursday night following a riot on Lanark Way, close to the interface in the west of the city. Both are charged with rioting, while Maitland faces a further charge of possessing petrol bombs in suspicious circumstances. And Forbes magazine has deleted a story calling Limerick City the murder capital of Europe. The Collison brothers, the founders of the billion-dollar web payments firm Stripe, and the subject of the profile piece, dismissed it as daft and mistaken. Fianna Fáil TD for Limerick City, Willie O'Dea, says it was a grotesque misrepresentation.
It's literally a different place to live, and how somebody could write such a piece without even a cursory check on the facts. I mean, did he check the murder statistics in Ireland? Did he check the murder statistics in Europe? Murder capital of Europe. I mean, what a load of nonsense.
It's 2 minutes past four.
News Talk weather.
Sunny spells and widespread showers this afternoon, some turning heavy and thundery. Some of them too may fall as hail or sleet and snow on high ground. Cold with highs of just 5 to 8 degrees. And now you're up to date on News Talk.
Football on Off the Ball.
With Paddy Power. Ready for your next big move? The trip from the fridge to the couch. Gamble responsibly. Gamblingcare.ie.
And you're welcome back to Off the Ball Saturday here on News Talk. John Duggan with you through until 8 o'clock because we got commentary of Leinster against Exeter in the Champions Cup. That's from 5:30. We'll also give you the Grand National result at 5:15. Joined by Damien Delaney and Johnny Ward to speak about the beautiful game. 53106 for your text messages. You can also tweet us at Off the Ball. You can listen to us on News Talk. You can watch us on the social channels for Periscope and Twitter at Off the Ball, on YouTube, Facebook, and on the OTB Sports app. Damien, we were just speaking about Arsenal before the break. Leaving Aubameyang out, was that the right decision for Arteta to make during the week?
Yeah, I think so. And I think it's only a matter of time before they take the captaincy off him as well. I mean, it's what a catastrophic, Ozil-esque type decision from Arsenal to finally offload someone like Ozil, who, you know, arguably wasn't living up to his salary. And then they turn around and give it straight to Aubameyang, and a character who seems to be heading down the same route. I've watched him numerous times this year, and his attitude stinks. For a football player, never mind a captain. He saw him in the Olympiacos game at the Emirates, and I mean, the lack of interest, energy, desire for a fella who knows that his team is on its knees, and you're looking for a guy to lead. I can't imagine going into training with him that he sets any sort of an amazing standard. I think he was made captain because he was their best player, and probably made captain along the lines of to try and get him to stay, and hopefully that, you know, the carrot of being captain would have kept him at the Emirates, because he did have that one season where he was brilliant and scored all those goals. But I could imagine someone like Kieran Tierney ending up with the captain's armband at Arsenal, and fairly soon as well. It might be a bit hasty to do it now mid-season. Might stink of a little bit of panic from the manager if he did that, but he cannot be happy with Aubameyang's behaviour, his conduct on and off the pitch, because obviously he was late for the North London Derby as well. And he puts his manager in such a bad position there, because obviously Arteta's come in and tried to lay down the law and set a standard of discipline at the football club. And obviously it's aimed at a certain group of players who were notoriously late or lack professionalism. So you set these really high standards, thinking that you're good professionals and your captain will be okay. And then your captain arrives in late. Then the manager has to drop him, because if that's the disciplinary standard he's set, and then he kind of flinches him for a second and plays Aubameyang after being late, well, then he's done for, you know. Now, luckily, they won the North London Derby, but if they'd have lost that, I think, for a player of his magnitude, of his contract, of his role at the football club, to be late for North London Derby is... I won't say it's unforgivable, but it's it would require an awful lot of making up.
It was I was just thinking to myself, where are they going to progress? How are they going to progress? I know you said kind of tongue in cheek that they need 700 million, but what can Arteta have to do in the summer to try and get them into a better place next season?
I think that a bit of consistency, really, and that comes from, I suppose, the players having a standard. that they kind of, a bare minimum, that even on their off days, they can produce something to get them through games. At the minute, their off days are bloody catastrophic. And every now and again, they have good days. That inconsistency probably stems from in my experience, I'm not well being on the inside of Arsenal, I don't know, but when you see teams that are as inconsistent as that, there usually is a lack of discipline around the training ground with regards to timekeeping, with regards to extra work. You know, if you go in the gym before training, all the good teams that I've been a part of, all the successful teams that have achieved something, either a promotion or kind of a good season, you go in the gym in the morning and it's packed. You come in at 8:30, even though you don't have to be until 9:30 or whatever. At 8:30, everybody's in the building because there's a work ethic and a willingness to work. And there's a feeling where the dressing room polices itself. There's a feeling that you don't want to let the team down, not just the manager, but you don't want to be the one that skips out in a weight session or comes in late because you feel you have an affection towards your teammates that you don't want to let them down. And that's generally our teams that are the complete opposite of that. You know, you come in the morning, the canteen is packed. Fellas are bringing in newspapers, magazines. Fellas are sitting on couches, coming in at 9:29 if they've got to be in for 9:30 at the best, you know, and then they're arguing that they're in the car park and you're saying, well, you know, you're supposed to be in the gym at 9:30, and you end up having these arguments with players and it gets out of hand then, to be honest with you. So, you know, fellas that come in and just, you know, as soon as training finishes, you can hear the car starting up in the car park before some players have even left the pitch. And you're kind of walking around the corner and you see that a certain number of players are gone at like 12:30, 15 minutes after the actual session finished. So those are the types of traits that inconsistent teams that lack cohesion have.
And I was just thinking about managers, because I read a really interesting piece in The Athletic. I'll just kind of refer to it here. Fascinating about the actual pressure of management. So Niall Quinn describing it as the toughest gig in the world. Ricky Spraglia referencing 168 phone calls he got when he got the Sunderland job. Gary Monk talking about the relief of being sacked. Brian McDermott recounting how he drank to medicate the pain of losing the playoff final. And managing up as well was difficult. Alex Ferguson famously went to bed after United lost 5-1 to City in 1989. It's been well documented, your experience with Roy Keane, Damien. But I think you need a certain type of breed to succeed. And that's also kind of fits into the conversation we're just having there about Aubameyang and Arsenal and a culture of a club with Arteta, who's kind of finding his feet in management. You do need a certain type, don't you?
Yeah, absolutely. You have to have a certain mentality and a certain will and a certain desire, I suppose, to succeed. And I suppose it's probably the reason I'm sat here talking to you at the minute, because if I was to go down the coaching road, I understand what it entails. And I understand from, you know, speaking to managers towards the latter end of my career of what it entails. And it's not something that I'm quite ready for at the minute. I don't think I would have the energy to do it. And going into coaching isn't something I do just for the sake of it. A lot of players just think, well, I've got nothing else to do. Might as well just do my badges and be a coach without really anticipating what it entails. Whereas I am well aware from my position, I can only imagine what it's like on the inside of a manager. I've seen managers just do some of the craziest things, but that's pressure. You know, when a manager's under pressure, it distorts his view of what's actually happening. And the really, really good managers can come under an extreme amount of pressure, but kind of reset themselves, recenter themselves, and see the wood from the trees. Because it's very, very easy to make a decision like what Arteta did with Aubameyang being late. And all of a sudden you're thinking, my God, if we lose this Tottenham game, I might lose my job. So then you compromise your beliefs, you compromise your principles by saying, OK, just this one time, Aubameyang's late, but I'm going to play him. So I admire Arteta so much for sticking by it. Now, I suppose he had to, but sometimes managers will think, well, you know, these are extenuating circumstances and I do have to compromise my beliefs. And sometimes you can get in a tailspin, and I do understand what managers go through to an extent. I would never understand it until you're actually the one on the sideline and the fans are chanting, you're getting sacked in the morning. You know, that's a difficult place to be and maintain your, I suppose, dignity for one word, but also your belief system. So I have a lot of respect for anyone that goes into management, but it's a lonely world.
Who impressed you then in the dressing room?
As a manager?
Yeah.
Oh, without doubt for me, the best manager that I had at dealing with that type of stuff was Roy Hodgson. But he's 72 years of age. So I don't fancy being in football for the next 35 years, to get to that level of patience. what I admired most about him and the likes of, you know, Sam Allardyce was quite good at it as well, is that, and I didn't play much my last year, I've said this before, so I kind of was able to observe and speak to Roy Hodgson and learn a few things. But Roy had this amazing ability that no matter what happened on the training ground or in a game, he always had this ability to stand there with this look on his face that said, I knew that was going to happen and I've got just the answer for this. Even though inside he was doing somersaults, panicking, or just, you know, losing the run of himself, he always managed to stand there and say the right thing at the right time. He always understood what the change room needed to hear, when it needed to kind of an earful or a berating, or when it needed to be told you're doing okay, even though the players don't believe we're doing okay, it's going horrifically badly, but, you know, the manager just needs to pick you up and give you a bit of confidence. So he was brilliant at it, but I'm sure that's a skill that's acquired over, you know, a 50-year managerial career, a 40-year managerial career, whatever he's had, because I know he has been a manager a very, very long time all over Europe. He's been very, very good. And then on the other side, you've got managers who just lose the plot at the smallest or easiest little thing. And then once you start down that road, it loses its effect because managers are losing the rag five times a day and you're only in till lunchtime. But you see the managers going off again and eventually players just kind of switch off from that and it loses its effect.
Maybe Roy Hodgson's was rooted in failures, Liverpool, England. Stephen Kenny, is his biggest issue now going forward to the next year, Damien? Not even tactics, not even how we play, and we all know about that debate, but actually man management of the players?
I don't think so. I think international football is a little bit different because it's a patriotic duty that when you come in, you want to come in essentially. You know, whereas sometimes if it's going against you at the club, you can go and see the manager and ask for a transfer and move on. So I suppose motivating players for Ireland shouldn't be the bulk of that job, shouldn't be a big issue. Stephen, I don't think we'll ever have an issue with players coming in. But I suppose if he doesn't start getting some results quickly, players will subconsciously switch off or maybe just kind of lose their edge a little bit because, you know, it's difficult, you know, when the manager is saying certain things and are not coming true, or you lose a little bit of belief in him. But he does have a big job at the minute. I think my personal opinion is his biggest job in the next 12 months will be handling the Irish public and media side of it. He's obviously, not obviously, but I think he's a pretty decent football man. But over the last number of weeks, I suppose when he comes out in his interviews afterwards and, you know, he's saying very interesting things like that the Serbia performance was the best performance of an Irish team in recent memory, debatable. When he says things like, you know, we should have won against Luxembourg, very debatable. And when he said that we should have beat Qatar, I think that was very debatable too. So, I mean, you know, if you come up and start saying things like that, the public aren't idiots. They don't need me or anyone else to tell them when something doesn't sound right, you know. So he has an awful lot of, in my opinion, I think he's an awful lot of goodwill from the Irish people. There's an awful lot of people want him to succeed. There's an awful lot of people rooting for him. And I suppose the quickest way to lose that goodwill is to come out and kind of debatable comments after games. I think, you know, if you come out afterwards and say, look, you know, we deserve to lose that game or we definitely deserve to win it, people will go, yeah, that's fair enough. But then you kind of give it, I'm working hard though, I'm doing my best. You know, I have a big job in my hands here to turn Irish football around, but trust me, I'm working hard. I think you get an awful lot more sympathy from the Irish public by going down that road.
Johnny, you want to come in there?
Yeah, I'm wondering just from Damo's perspective, you know, I was observing the Luxembourg game and obviously in the, I suppose, the last 5 minutes anyway, certainly after we went behind, you know, the camera was focused on Stephen Kenny a lot. And I have to say, you know, Stephen Kenny, he's a quite eccentric character in ways, you know, and you can kind of tell that from his press conference. But I was wondering, what is the dressing room going to be like as he goes in there? And you're saying about Roy Hodgson, everything kind of can be explained in terms of his body language and the way he behaves. But Stephen Kenny had to go into that dressing room. And I read, you know, somewhere that I read one of the reports that he was pretty quiet in the dressing room afterwards, which didn't surprise me. But how important, if you're a player, say you've come, you played for Ireland in that game against Luxembourg, which I would agree, I don't think they deserve to win the game. I think if anything, the best they deserve is a draw. But how important for you as a player when you go off the pitch and your captain is basically saying some players weren't brave, didn't look for the ball, you know, it was a disgrace, using all these words. How important is it as a player that your manager, who himself is rather improving at this level, reassures you and gives you the right message?
Well, that's just it, you know. I mean, a lot of players in that Ireland change room are very, very experienced, and they can see through a manager that's kind of telling them fibs is a very, very hard word. But, you know, a manager that's kind of saying you're doing great. Now, I know I said earlier Roy Hodgson is saying that, but players know he's just trying to G us up. And, you know, you understand that the last thing this team needs right now is the kitchen sink thrown at them. That, you know, they're trying very, very hard. They're doing their best, and they just need an arm around them, I suppose. So it'll just be a feeling in the changing room. But without being on the inside, it'd be very, very slow to offer an opinion of what's going on in the changing room. But I've said before that with Seamus Coleman as captain, I wouldn't envisage too many problems. You know, Seamus is such a big character that a lot of players will gravitate towards him. And when Seamus comes out and says something like he said, you wouldn't take it lightly. And a lot of players would tend to agree with Seamus there that it was a very, very difficult night for us, and it wasn't a good performance, really, and we most certainly didn't deserve to win that game. So it's difficult to comment on that, but, you know, as I said, I think Stephen's biggest job is keeping the public support and the goodwill that he has had up until now, maintaining that over the current, you know, World Cup qualifying campaign, which is over in September, October, November, October. You know, because I think a lot of people would be happy to give Stephen, you know, a full qualifying campaign. Now, obviously, we need to see some signs over that. But if people do see some signs and people like Stephen and they think we're moving in the right direction, or we're kind of, the needle has been moved a little bit, then I think people will believe in him a little bit more. But it's just keeping the public on side, which is power management. You know, football management isn't just about putting on your boots, putting on a training session. You have all sorts of things to deal with, you know, everything from media through to players to coaching to everything. So it's all encompassing. So how he manages that over the next 8-9 months, whatever it is, till the end of the World Cup qualifying campaign, and I think he deserves one full qualifying campaign. And I think at the end of that, then we should assess where we are and assess, has there been enough improvement? Does he deserve another qualifying campaign or Nations League, whatever's up next after that?
We've got a goal. Liverpool have scored against Aston Villa. So Liverpool 1, Aston Villa 1 in the Premier League. 57 minutes on the watch. Mo Salah with the goal for the Reds at Anfield earlier on. Leeds winning 2-1 away to Manchester City, the league leaders. Just give you some scores from the Championship as well. Let you know that Crystal Palace play Chelsea at 5:30. We also have a 5:30 start for the Leinster-Exeter Champions Cup match, which we have live here on News Talk with Neil Tracy and Johnny Murphy. Full-time Millwall 0, Swansea 3. And latest scores, Bournemouth 2, Coventry 1. It's Barnsley 0, Middlesbrough 0. Birmingham City 2, Stoke City 0. It's Bristol City 0, Nottingham Forest 0. Cardiff City 1, Blackburn Rovers 1. Derby County 0, Norwich City 1. Huddersfield Town 0, Rotherham United 0. Preston 0, Brentford 2. QPR 2, Sheffield Wednesday 1. And Wycombe Wanderers 1, Luton Town 0. These are the scores in the Championship at the moment. And we have that goal, Liverpool against Aston Villa. Let's hear about it from Shane Pennington.
It's Liverpool 1, Aston Villa 1, and this goal does stand. There's no lengthy VAR review on this. It was Andy Robertson with a cross shot from the left-hand side of the penalty area. It was well saved by Emi Martinez, but he could only push it out as far as Mo Salah and 6 yards out. Salah just headed it into the back of the empty net. It's Liverpool 1, Aston Villa 1.
Don't forget, on next week's Paddy Power Half Hour, we're continuing with our new segment, Near Miss, aimed at allowing you to reclaim a losing bet. So if you've had a single bet or an accumulator that's fallen down just before you fling your phone at the wall, take a screen grab of your losing bet. Be sure to include your bet slip ID. Just send it in to us either using the PP Near Miss hashtag on Twitter, or hit us with a DM on Instagram, or send us your snap on WhatsApp to 087 9180 180 087 9180 180. We will do the rest. We'll announce the selected winners every Friday at the end of the Paddy Power Half Hour. You can see the T's and C's on otbsports.com. Stay tuned as well to our OTB social accounts for more. This week saw Nicky Daly win back €1,400 and Barry Kent €700 from losing bets. So information on responsible gambling, visit gamblingcare.ie. Good, Johnny, to see the young lad playing for Norwich today from Leipzig. Andrew Omoba Medele is in, got a glowing praise from Daniel Farke during the week, and he's back in the team as well for the league leaders in the Championship, who are leading the way to Derby.
Yeah, I mean, we've obviously had, I guess we've all kind of had major hopes for this, what I would have called, what probably others would have called, the golden generation coming through. Adam Mead, Jason Malumbi, Jason Knight, obviously Troy Parrott, some of the defenders, the goalkeepers, I think we can be more positive on. But this kid, just from speaking to Alan Reynolds, I he's glowing in praise for him. And, you know, to man the match for his first game for Norwich, to be doing this at 18, it's interesting that, you know, he bypassed the League of Ireland. He went over from League Slip to Norwich. And this is kind of an interesting, I suppose, study in terms of where these players can go post-Brexit and all that. He went over as a young lad to Norwich. And I think, I don't know, Damien, what you make of it, but just at the age he's at, to be playing in that position and to be so, you know, impressive so far, it does imply that he's kind of extraordinary ability in terms of an Irish player anyway. It's something to be very hopeful of. I have been kind of in contact with Alan Reynolds from the 21s, and he would be very, very hopeful about some of the players coming through. And this guy possibly looks like the most promising of the lot.
Yeah, it's anytime you're playing regularly in any team, especially at Championship level, it means you're doing something right. But he's in a great environment to learn and to get better. Norwich are winning every week. The team is probably a well-oiled machine with the manager there. He's been there through a promotion, a relegation, a promotion again. So he obviously has come in and done really, really well. But I suppose the mark of any player is if they get promoted, if he can get a run of games under his belt. You know, we saw last year with Darragh O'Shea going up with West Brom. And he's had a difficult-ish year. So if Norwich can come up and learn the lessons of the relegation they had previously, and this guy can play certain amount of games and improve again, it'll stand to Irish football absolutely, because the more players we have playing in the top division, the better obviously for the manager and the Irish national team moving forward. So look, it's a positive thing, it's a good thing. Anytime we get a player playing first team football, especially at the upper echelons of the Championship, is a good thing.
Trezeguet's hit the post.
Adamipo Obiduku, who's Odebuku, who's he's a talent kid who's been playing kind of from Ireland at the underage, and he's very highly regarded. There is now a suggestion that he might be possibly looking at switching allegiance, which is, you know, that's the word in the grapevine in terms of what he might be doing, and that'll definitely be monitored because he's very highly regarded. And there are kind of a lot of these young kids coming through who would be, you know, eligible for other countries as well. And that's something that's going to become a big issue for us going forward. We've seen it, how much we could have done with Declan Rice, how much could have done with obviously Grealish and all that. But these players with kind of African heritage on one side as well, they will have options. And it's important that Ireland aren't crap going forward, because these players will have options to play for other teams.
Yeah, but we need to get a good chunk of those kids through. So even if you do lose a few to either England or whatever team they're eligible to play for also. It's a numbers thing. The more we can get through, the more we can get in first teams, the more chance we have of keeping some very, very good ones.
Liverpool 1, Villa 1, as I just said there. Villa have hit the post through Trezeguet, 63 minutes on the watch in the Premier League at Anfield. Just to let you know that our coverage is thanks to Paddy Power. So for information on responsible gambling, visit gamblingcare.ie. Our commentary game tomorrow here on News Talking Off the Ball is Spurs Man United. Jose Mourinho against his old club, Harry Kane, we spoke about earlier in the show. Just on United, probably into the semis now of the Europa League, Damien, a 2-0 win over Granada during the week. Kind of a rumour out there or feeling that Declan Rice could end up at Old Trafford. Would he be the right man for them? Would he be a signing that they could do with?
I think so. I think a Declan Rice or similar type of player would be the number one target for Manchester United, really, moving forward. A good, dominant number six that can lead the midfield would be crucial for them. It would potentially open up to playing a bit more of an exciting brand of football. Some of the games of Man United have been a tough watch, even games they've won. You know, the Brighton game wasn't great. And then, obviously, the game last in the Europa League against Granada was okay. So, look, I think to get the likes of Donny van de Beek and I've said all this a million times anyway before. I've annoyed enough.
People might be listening for the first time, though. It's the very first time.
I'm not going down that road again. Jesus, incurring the wrath of Man United fans. Look, first and foremost, they need to get through this season, and I think they need to win a trophy. That would be my number one kind of progress marker for Manchester United. They have a good chance. They're in the semi-finals of a tournament that they're capable of winning, but it's going to be very, very difficult because even though they'll come through against Granada, they're going to play a very, very good team in the semi-finals and a very, very good team in the finals as well. So it's going to be difficult for them. I still stand by my earlier assertions that he needs to win a trophy at Manchester United.
Could do with a striker as well, or do you think?
Well, they've kind of ham and egged their approach to it, you know, with the likes of Igalo and that. And Man United's PR machine is in full swing, and Igalo was the second coming, and then Cavani was the second coming. But they're supplementary players, like what Ferguson did with Henrik Larsson. You get in those types of players as your fourth choice striker, and if you can get five Michael Owen the back end of his career, but you don't bring them in as your main man. I mean, sooner or later, Man United are going to have to break the bank and sign a Haaland or sign a Harry Kane or sign somebody, that can lead the line for them. You know, Robin van Persie style, Van Nistelrooy type, you know, real cutting edge striker. They have to go and get that. They also need a really, really good number six. I think they believe they need another centre-back as well to really, really compete at the upper echelons of the Premier League and the latter stages of the Champions League. If they don't do that, well, then they're going to be continually playing on Thursday nights against the likes of Granada.
5-3-1-0-6.
Needing to win something. Sorry, JD. I just like it's all about Champions League now, really. Getting into the Champions League year.
Oh, Johnny, stop, will you? I can't.
Is FA Cups winning League Cups? Like, ultimately, whatever. It's all about getting into the Champions League. I'm not wrong. That's just. I wish I was wrong. I wish it was like the old days. Maybe I'm harping back to the old days again. But it's about finishing in the top four, and that's far more important than winning League Cups or FA Cups.
Do you know the last manager to say that was Wenger? That finishing in the top four was equivalent to winning a trophy. As soon as you lower the bar, you lower the standard. We don't need a trophy anymore. Top four is good enough. That's it. You're done. You're shot. Chelsea don't accept that. Abramovich doesn't accept it. PSG don't accept it. Clubs like that ilk are about winning. Supplementary trophies, League Cups, FA Cups, absolutely. But leagues, Champions Leagues, that's what these clubs are about. And if not winning them, then absolutely competing at the latter ends of them. As soon as Man United lower the bar, they're finished. They're done. And I feel a lot of Man United fans have lowered the bar. Top four is good enough. It's not. You see, like, you know, ex-players of Manchester United saying stuff like, oh, well, it's progress. Could you imagine those players in the changing room and a manager, Paul Moss, and them saying, oh, it's progress? They'd burn the place down if they weren't winning trophies. So you can't lower your standards. Man United, it's about winning. That's it. Nothing else.
Yeah, but winning the League Cup and winning the FA Cup, it's about obviously challenging and being good in the league and closing the gap. But Manchester City are so strong at the moment. I think for Manchester United to finish second is a hell of an achievement and far more important than win the League Cup.
Wasn't good enough for Jose.
Exactly. Lampard.
Complacency going or whatever, but to me, like, managers like Ole Gunnar Solskjaer is not going to keep his job on what he does in the League Cup or the FA Cup, and probably even the Europa League as well. Grand if you win that, but it's about being competitive in the league and getting into the Champions League and taking it from there.
Everyone, the buzzword around Solskjaer at the moment is progress, and supplementary trophies like the Europa League, like the League Cup, like the FA Cup are markers of that progress. Because you're not going to go from getting beaten cup semi-finals regularly to all of a sudden competing in Champions League semi-finals. There's markers along the road. And if he's talking about progress, then he needs to start winning some of these lesser trophies that you're saying are easily winnable for Manchester United. They're not even winning then. So what chance have they got? Could you imagine Man United going up against Bayern or Real? I mean, they would be hosed off the park. They're nowhere near that. But to progress...
No, they absolutely wouldn't. They absolutely would not. They went to Man City and produced an unbelievable performance. City are favourites to win the Champions League. Man United could easily be competitive. Real are no great shakes themselves at the moment. They're just there because Liverpool, like, they beat Liverpool 3-1. But Man United would be very competitive. They're actually well set up to play against these good teams as well. They have some world-class players. I think you're underestimating them. And they've been very good against City, who are arguably the best team in Europe.
Oh, my God. Honestly, John. Like, I mean, one-off games against City. Manchester United is about winning. Absolute juggernaut of England. Dominant force. Schoolyard bully. Mowing around England and just taking everyone down and marching into the Champions League ladder stages. At the minute, they're stumbling around against Brighton. First half against Granada. I mean, they're nowhere near the top end of the league. If they finish second, it'll be by default because Liverpool have capitulated. Mm-hmm. Chelsea still might catch them, if I'm being honest with you. But if they finish second, let's be honest, they've got 60 points from 30 games. It's not exactly earth-shattering numbers. Like, you know, when you look at 100 points winning a Premier League, you know, 2 points a game, they're going to finish up at, what, 80-ish points? They're still a long, long way away from catching City.
53106, fully agree with Delaney. Funny, if you close your eyes, you swear it's Roy Keane.
No, I'm not. At least
a goal to manager. Where's your attempt, Amo?
I'm sitting here chatting to you about it.
No. We're having brilliant radio here on News Talking Off the Ball here across the nation with Damien Delaney and Johnny Ward. I'm just kind of wondering, should I have butter, popcorn, or salted? I haven't decided yet.
Johnny, are you a Man United fan?
Me?
Johnny. I'm a Go United fan and a Liverpool fan, but I don't think it's as easy for a Solskjaer to do the job that you're saying in the circumstances. I think he's done a reasonably good job at Man United, and I don't think winning FA Cups or League Cups really matter in the overall scheme of things.
When was reasonably good enough for Manchester United? You look at Abramovich, Lampard was doing a reasonably good job. Reasonably good job is acceptable.
It was fascinating what Abramovich came out with. Abramovich did an interview with Forbes recently, and he just said, effectively, managers don't matter. The only thing that matters are trophies. And you can't argue with that. I know as a Spurs fan, we've an empty cabinet for 50 years. But it was just the lack of sentimentality towards managers was fascinating. No, it's about results. It's about trophies. That's it. I actually don't like that in a way, but that is the reality of what's going on at Chelsea. Tuchel's doing an amazing job. If Tuchel was at United, would United be doing better than Solskjaer?
You can't say that though, because like Abramovich's style of just basically every political career ends in failure, every Chelsea manager's career ends in failure because he'll eventually get rid of them. And he basically is running the club as a bit of a plaything, something for himself to enjoy himself, to distract himself from all the money he has. Man United is running in a very different way, and arguably not a particularly good way either. But please don't be telling me like Abramovich is great because he hires and sacks coaches, because that's not how football should work. Football should be about giving a young manager time. If you entrust Solskjaer with the job, give him time. And Man United have been brilliant at giving managers time. The fans have been very patient. This crack of just hiring and sacking managers within a year is done by idiots who don't understand the game.
I couldn't disagree with anything more than what you just said there. Chelsea are about winning, and that's the prerequisite. When you interview Abramovich or whoever you sit down with, you're told, first of all, not just winning, you need to play good football too. And they're the two prerequisites. Give us that and you can keep your job. If you give me one route the other, we might hang on to you a little bit. The only manager that ever got a break under Abramovich was Frank Lampard when they had the transfer embargo. That's the only time he actually stood back, and I think that's quite fair. But ultimately, there's a reason Chelsea won the most trophies in England since Abramovich took over. It's because he sets the bar at success.
So you'd like your club run by someone like Roman Abramovich?
I believe that these top clubs are like that, yeah. Manchester United, Liverpool's, they're all exact same.
Well, the Glazers are now, they're not exactly wonderful.
I mean, would you like your football club run by somebody like that who just made masses of money? However he's done it, I think that's another issue. And basically has this as something of a plaything to entertain himself on Saturday and doesn't give a damn about the manager, just sacks him because he wants to win. If you think like football clubs in England are going to be run by Roman Abramovich's left, right and centre, it's gone down a very, very bad road.
Maybe it already is, though.
But he's entitled to do that. It's his club. He's the owner. I think Chelsea fans aren't complaining.
There should be financial fair play that you can't sack managers willy-nilly. That if you invest in a manager, you more or less, unless you want to just throw money left, right and centre, pay them their contracts and just bring somebody else in on massive wages. Like I wouldn't get much pleasure from watching like Roman Abramovich cheering on my team that I've been supporting since I was a kid, and he just comes along and just lavishes money at it to give himself some entertainment at the weekend. Wouldn't be for me at all.
Well, all those Chelsea fans that don't like it can go and support Arsenal.
Shay.
53106, listeners, if you want to get involved in this, agree with Damien, lads. If United are so competitive against these big teams, why aren't they still in the Champions League? That is from Niall in Dublin. I did 100 days of walking to finish it today. How have you been getting on with your lockdown exercise, just to kind of cool down the atmosphere in the room here? Damien, are you getting a bit of running around the park, or what are you doing?
Yeah, I'm a big cycling enthusiast, so I go out 2 or 3 times a week and do 40K on my bike, obviously in 5K loops because of the whole thing. So, I get out 2 or 3 times a week on my bike.
And is it competitive, or is it just more of a leisurely thing?
It's not competitive. I have certain kind of times and average speeds that I try and keep. So I do my best to do that. obviously, would have been the weekend. Now there'll be a couple of bottles of wine over the weekend, so the cycling might be a bit more of a leg spin than anything else. But at least twice a week, I do like to get out and get on some hills and stuff like that. So that's what I do.
Was it hard to adjust to not playing football anymore? Is there in any way a kind of a window where your fitness does drop a little bit?
Yeah, but I was delighted to be honest with you. I couldn't have, you know, I think no, it's just more about fighting the tide and keeping the weight off, to be honest with you, as opposed to actually doing anything, breaking any records or anything. So I'm a little bit like the Dutch boy in the dam now, just going for cycles just to hold back the water, to be honest with you. So that's just the extent of it for me, just for mentally as well. It's pretty good just to go out for, you know, 45 minutes an hour, depending on what I do. And you come back, you always feel better after it. So I have no issue going out. I cycle through the winter as well. I've all the winter gear and everything like that. So I do get out on the bike all year round, yeah.
Well, you met your twin, because Johnny, you're a big bike man as well, aren't you?
This is mad. Like, I've always known me and Damien were effectively kindred spirits, you know.
Apart from Man United.
Yeah, what Timo said there is exactly what I've been doing in terms of the lockdown. Yeah, around this time last year, I was cycling and I've been doing the 5K loop. 40K is kind of my regular cycle. Try to do it as competitively as I can. Isn't a very hilly route, but it's amazingly good for you. Like, I couldn't. The only thing I'd say against cycling is how dangerous it is, particularly if you're in traffic or whatever. But it's so good for the mind. And as much as like cycling a bike might seem boring, there's an awful lot to it, and it's brilliant for regulating how you eat in the day. Brilliant for giving you a kind of a natural tiredness. And great for seeing the, you know, probably parts of your own country you didn't appreciate as well. And great for comparing times with Damien Delaney after the show.
I can see my future, a crystal ball. It's a TV series. Damien Delaney and Johnny Ward across Ireland.
I beat him on climbs because I'm... What weight are you, Demo?
90 kilos.
I'm 65, so if I can't beat him on climbs, I'm in trouble. But I'd say in terms of a time trial or anything that doesn't involve me making advantage of not being very heavy, I'd probably be in trouble. But yeah, it'd be interesting. Maybe we'll have some sort of a race and raise a few bob for charity or something like that down the line.
Wow. Yeah, that would be good. You, me and Kenny Cunningham would be a great little trio, that, wouldn't it? Just arguing our way around Ireland cycling.
No, it's going to be on TV. It's going to be on TV in the next couple of years. All producers, TV show people, I know you're listening in now. Just get it and make it sure it happens. Well, hopefully, whatever you do the rest of the weekend, you enjoy it. Damien and Johnny, take care. Thanks so much.
Thanks, lads.
Thanks, Judy.
Okay, this is Off the Ball Saturday on News Talk. Liverpool 1, Aston Villa 1 in the Premier League. Our radio is continuing until 8, and you can also watch us as well on the social channels for Off the Ball. We got Leinster and Exeter coming up at 5:30, commentary of that. And we'll preview Ireland's game against Wales in the Women's Six Nations after this.
Football on Off the Ball
with Paddy Power. Only the cream of the crop pick up Champions League medals. Jonathan Greening's got one. Gamble responsibly. Gamblingcare.ie.
Show Me the Science with Professor Luke O'Neill.
A Newstalk original podcast series focusing on different issues, from the serious to the silly. All explained through science. Catch up on the podcast series at newstalk.com or on the Newstalk app.
I can depend on my partner. I can depend on my own judgment. I can depend on my doctor and my pharmacist.